to make technical monitoring, improve that. Yeah, for people who used the earlier libs.grep versions, and for operators or DevOps who want to get more information about what they can monitor of the technical state of the machines. You should have learned something about object-oriented technologies before. You should have wrote some code before, otherwise the examples might be not good understandable for you. Yeah, and you should have seen some Unix or some Perl before. The examples make a lot of use of XS and C because of the higher portability. We are starting the host information. Everyone knows uname, but parsing uname is in fact a bit difficult. So you can access each value by doing a simple call. What's often important is how fast can we calculate bigger numbers. So the bitwidth of the host is interesting. You are caring, is it a physical host or is it a virtual machine on monitoring? You want to know how many virtual CPUs are currently operating in my system. How many can I maximum? So, do I need to extend my capacity on demand contracts with my supplier? You need to need the uptime of the machine, and of course always, how old are your information? You want to see CPU stats, of course. You want to know how many times are spent in kernel processing, user processing, how many clock ticks your system is wasting in idle states or doing I/O swapping, rescheduling, how many context switches are on your host. This is important in a lot of cases when maybe you have a defect network card, then your involuntary context switches will grow. Or you have some file system corruption, then probably a process is waiting for a file system lock, which made a lot of voluntary context switches. All those information, you of course have to know what to measure, are important for doing a correct technical monitoring. Yeah, but CPU stats, they are hardware numbers. They are probably not so comparable between different hosts. And when you want to know which hardware needs to be extended or which application needs to be moved, you probably need the percentage usage of the machine. Well, that's finally the same value, but it's relative to the machine. So when you know your applications using 90% of the CPU time of the machine, then you probably need a bigger machine. When you're seeing the I/O is taking a lot of CPU time, you probably need faster disks or a better I/O controller. InfiniBand sounds nice these days. So, this is important for recognizing peaks. You need to know, well, when your application probably does not answer in a proper time, does it always happen every minute? Does it only happen sometimes and your 5 or 15 minutes load is okay? So do you have peak, do you have denial of service attacks probably? You can see it by measuring the load. Yeah, this one is primarily for seeing long-term involvement. So looking for leaking applications, for example. You sometimes don't see that because you have great operating systems these days. They do a lot of good virtual memory management, and you don't see that an application is leaked because swapping and virtual memory management is very good. So you need to see the involvement of used and free memory compared to your total installed memory. As the same situation, you need to compare that to the swapping of your machine. If you run out of swapping, your machine cannot answer anymore. You can't log in, and you need to see that very early. So you probably want to set an alarm when your free swap runs below a certain point. Yeah, the same thing about I/O weight on the CPU might be interesting for several disks. So you have a long I/O because probably you have a defect disk, and you can see that when your disk I/O from one disk shrinks below a value of all your other disks in your system, when you have a RAID system, for example, or compared to the last week, or whatever you measure. Paging stats is, for example, important when you have when you have a leaking process which runs for a long time, then you see that your page out is very, very bigger than your page in. That points to a leaking process. If your page in and your page out are in sync, then you probably need much more memory than your system have installed. Then you should increase your main memory. File system, yeah, that's the same for your disks, like what is for memory. When your file systems are full, you cannot create new files, you cannot write log files, you cannot log in anymore because there's no possibility to create your session, which is finally a file. So, you should have alarms when your file systems grow to whatever you need. That always depends on your system. Well, on a 10 terabyte RAID, it's not so important if you have only 1 terabyte free, but on a 250 gigabyte disk, 10% might be critical. You could measure what users are logged on a production server somewhere in your DMZ. There should be only some machine users, transfer users, and from time to time an operator. When you have users logged in from probably an unknown device, then you might have a hacker on your system. That should be an alarm. Or if you have a wild running monitoring shell script from Nagios, that should be probably an alarm when you have switched to some other technology. Yeah, the same is for processes. You might sometimes told, yeah, your processes are leaking memory. You have a lot of swapping. Your page out increases. But who is responsible? With the process stats, you can figure that out. You see the name of the process the full qualified pass name, you can figure out who has started that. In most times, a machine user, of course, but you can figure out which team is responsible. Is it web team or is it database? You see probably when your responses of your web application slow down. Well, is it because of which process causes the wait because of the file system corruption, or which is there a specific process which is slowed down? Yeah, here in the process sites and process resident, you can see the memory used by the process. So you can filter out the low 5%, for example, and watch only the rest. You can see probably long running processes. When a process, like an Apache daemon, has not been restarted for a longer time, that's maybe unusual depending on your system configuration. If your Oracle database has time spent below 1 hour, you have probably always restarting database process. It's also not so good. Yeah, the networking I/O is important when you looking for traffic issues. You see your web traffic is going down and you want to see why. Are your transmissions and received things defect? So it might point to a defect port in the switch or hub. Or are your errors increasing, which might speak for defect cable, for example? Or do you have collisions? What means you need to add more switches and decrease the count of hubs in your network. Are your interfaces working correctly? If you buy an InfiniBand card and it operates on gigabit Ethernet only, yeah, there's something what would explain that you don't have so much traffic as you expect. Is your duplex not handshaked correctly? Or is it probably the interface down and you're routing about the backup interface? Yeah, all things you might be interested in. Yeah. The error details are much more important when something goes wrong when fetching the information. This is something you should look at when something happens. Which is probably important to know about all the statistics we have seen before. You can fetch it on every Unix system. Windows, we are working on that. But on every Unix system, you get a comparable information about the stats, and they are, when this value is available, fully filled. Yeah. How do we get those informations? Yeah. We derive the names of the getters from the stat names. So getting the host information is simply called get host info. The CPU stats, get CPU stats, and so on. There's a man page. There are some pod information. CPAN formats are nice. Have a look. This is a typical call when you want to get them to handle the error correctly. This is for all stat calls finally the same. We heavily worked on to have no specialty anymore compared to the last release. So you always get the same different plus data type, and in case of error you can directly combine with an OR operator, which is good implemented there. Okay. Some examples. All examples are provided with a module. Well, I'm not here to read the documentation. Well, you fetch, for example, the host information, and you can fetch always via method calls the different statistics. So if you read the main page of the statistic library, every attribute which is in the structures delivered back is the exact method name in Perl. So you don't have to read, oh, how is it matched? It's always the attribute name. So we have some examples. Hostname, file system, you see, well, there's a parameter to mount point. Well, this parameter is a number of the file system. You have probably more than one file system, as you have probably more than one process running. Well, finally two, the kernel and the init process, and maybe a login shell. And all methods are taking the number of the statistic entry. Some methods or some statistics have the ability to compute a difference for you, which is probably way more comfortable than calling 5 or 10 methods and subtract them from each other. So you have CPU starts, and you call new CPU starts and compare it to the last fetched value. You can do it every minute and then make a nice graph using RRD. You can do the same with disk starts, with file systems, network I/O, paging. Yeah, all the things where sizes which are changing over time are reasonably comparable. And as mentioned for CPU, you can calculate the percentage representation instead of numbers. Yeah, you can get more information if you go simply to the websites, the homepage of libs.grub, the CPAN page of the Perl module, or the meta CPAN page, which is cooler these days. There's a mailing list. You can ask for support. You can ask how we can implement new features. You can contact the authors very fast using IRC, as the same host where Perl 6 IRC channel resides, which is very important. Our release manager takes a lot of time and invested a lot of nerves controlling me. Yeah. Talks for doing a lot of tests on more exotic platforms like HPUX and AIX, and running Urban for checking out some, if we managed memory management correctly, had no overflows anymore. Yeah. And if you have questions and I cannot answer them here, don't hesitate, either ask the mailing list or me. So we have 1 minute left. If someone has a question here. Yeah?
Okay, is there something constraint? For example, it's working on all Unix or just in Linux?
It works on every Unix available, more or less. Well, we know on 264, this is a bit outdated. It's not running perfectly on 264, but it's on every modern Unix you can get. It's a list of, I think, meanwhile, 15 platforms we had one on.
Thank you.